Hi, Margaret.
Hi, Liz.
As head of Goldman Sachs' Urban Investment Group, you've spent years investing in underserved communities across the country, many of which are Black communities, and thinking about ways to close the opportunity gap. It's in these communities right now where we're seeing massive protests and demonstrations. Given your years of experience investing in these areas, what's your perspective on what's happening right now?
It is completely heartbreaking on all levels. In my own protesting this weekend, I witnessed levels of anguish and pain that are almost impossible, at least for me, to put into words, to bear witness to the literal screams and tears of people demanding very simply that their most basic personhood be put on par with other Americans and their worth not continuously litigated with deathly consequences like that of George Floyd. That is gut-wrenching. People protesting Black lives being killed. Everyone will stop and take notice when a Black man is killed in broad daylight. But as I think about the communities where we work, people are living with and experiencing racism and its history every single day. Right? These communities have still not recovered fully from racist, government-sanctioned policies around, lending and access to capital and the ability to buy homes dating back to the 1930s. And so my perspective on the tragedies we're witnessing is that if we want to make progress on all forms of equality, economic equality, healthcare, education, we first have to be very clear that the Black lives that fill these communities are worthy of being protected and they are worthy of being defended.
And Margaret, obviously this is happening against the backdrop of a global pandemic, which we know is impacting minority communities disproportionately. Describe in more detail the disparities that we're seeing.
These communities are clearly struggling disproportionately, and that is not just on the health side with the higher death rates we've seen amongst Blacks, the level of cases that we've seen concentrated in low-income communities, but we're also seeing that disparity on the economic side. Some examples there, we're seeing, Black and Hispanic unemployment rates at some of the highest in history, certainly disproportionate levels compared to whites. We are, I'll just give an example, that's nationwide, but they're also the majority, Black cities. I'll give Detroit as just one particularly disturbing example where researchers think unemployment is truly as high as 48%. We're also seeing kind of on top of that, this inability for these communities to really access relief on par with others. So we've seen for minority-owned businesses and businesses that are located in low-income communities, they've not been able to apply for, the Paycheck Protection Program loans at the same rate. They haven't been able to get to the queue and be approved at the same rate. And so that disparity of impact to this pandemic, we're seeing really equally on both the health and economic sides.
How much do we know about the factors that are driving these disparities?
None of us have all of the data that we will have, and I think that we want to have to understand all of this in more detail, but there are pictures that are becoming clearer. So if we think about just, as one example, one of the main protective, elements that we're all using in this pandemic, right, social distancing, you have to recognize that that's a privilege. Not everyone has the opportunity to do that. And if you think about just a place like New York City, for example, where, COVID has had a pretty disastrous impact, 75% of our essential workers are minorities. And these are the individuals who are, pretty clearly risking their own health and lives to really provide, services for the rest of us. And these, working class individuals, it's also their communities bearing the brunt of this. So, these working class families who live in places like the South Bronx or in Queens, we're seeing, the most disproportionate of those impacts. And so this link to the working class and who these communities are and where they work, right? These are all facts that predated this pandemic, but in this moment are creating some of the disparities we're seeing.
So Margaret, turning to the work that you spearhead for Goldman Sachs, investing in urban communities, how have urban revitalization efforts around the country been impacted by the economic shutdown?
So I think there are two pieces of it. There's the impact, you know, literally today in early June, as many of the projects and revitalization efforts that we're working on around the country are just literally stalled, right? We do a lot of building new buildings, whether that's, you know, new housing initiatives, schools, you know, community facilities. And so like many other parts of the economy, those things are just literally halted. And I don't worry so much about that. We will see communities reopen and see those initiatives continue. I would say where there's concern is to continue to do the type of work that we've seen be successful in the longer term. And when communities come together at the table and define what the needs are and really put plans together, and then you have public and private capital come together to help execute on some of those initiatives, that's when we move the needle. And it's really important to have that public sector partnership to do that. And the types of housing agencies and economic development agencies that we work with, they get their resources and capital from the exact same city budgets that we're seeing incredibly challenged right now. If you look at just, you know, New York City as an example, the draft budget for the next 2 years cuts affordable housing by 40%. And so I think we're going to need to be incredibly vigilant and committed and continue to, you know, raise the alarm about the priorities in these communities, even in the context of what's going to be very difficult prioritization and challenges in a challenging fiscal environment caused by the pandemic. But the good news is we can do this work. We just have to keep these communities top of mind, and we just have to keep these efforts prioritized.
So what do you think will really need to happen over the long term to strengthen these communities?
You know, there's no silver bullet. I think for communities where we've seen real movement, whether that's in you know, workforce development and educational attainment and health outcomes, that requires an incredibly comprehensive approach and a real thoughtful investment in not just the physical infrastructure in these communities, but the social infrastructure. And you know, I hate to overuse this concept of a village, but that really takes all of the, you know, educational anchors, cultural anchors, you know, corporate anchors, small businesses, everyone really coming together to make sure that there are robust opportunities for individuals and families in these communities. And then the actual fabric of these communities in and of themselves provide the types of opportunities that we all want in our livelihoods and our ability to take care of ourselves and support our families.
Margaret, thank you for talking to us during a very difficult time and for sharing your insights.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for listening.